Today, I will cover this topic of how to do hypothesis testing using MS Excel. Now, assume that there is this particular situation that we are facing. So there is a group of people who have been on a diet, okay? And we need to determine, has this diet helped them reduce their weight? So this is one situation, okay? And there is one more situation where there are two weight loss diets. Some experts consider diet 1 to be more effective and others consider diet 2 to be more effective. Here we need to determine which diet is really effective in reducing the weight. Is it diet 1 or is it diet 2? So that is what we have in the second situation. So in these kinds of situations, whenever you're faced with evaluating two specific options or when you have performed an experiment on certain groups of people, you do this hypothesis testing to see what is the effect of that experiment or whether that experiment has been really effective. So this is where you use the hypothesis testing. Okay. So what are the steps involved in this hypothesis testing if we see? So mainly there are three steps. First step is hypothesizing. So by hypothesizing, I mean we form some sort of an idea or some sort of an assumption regarding the experiment that we have made. So here in this diet scenario, we are hypothesizing that diet is helpful in reducing weight. So that is our hypothesis. And then we measure. Okay, so what do we measure here? Our target variable or the experiment is centered around the weight of the people, right? So we measure the weights of the people who participate in the experiment. And then we compare. And this is the actual statistical part where we perform some test to check whether this hypothesis is true or not. Okay. Now, the challenge here in this kind of hypothesis testing scenario is many test methods are available and we need to choose the right one. So what do I mean by many test methods? So just see this flowchart here. So now this is where it gets a little bit technical. So I am just saying when to use what test. Okay. So first see how many sample sets are we comparing. Okay, so are we comparing two sample sets or greater than two sample sets? I've got examples in the subsequent parts of the presentation. So we'll go over what this actually means. But for now, you can just remember that if you have two sample sets, then you have to check whether the two sets belong to the same group or whether the two sets belong to different groups. Okay. So if they belong to the same group, then this is the test that you perform. Paired, so you perform this t-test, and within the t-test you have several types. So here you perform paired two sample test for means. Okay, and if the two sets belong to the different groups, then you perform this f, you first perform this f-test to see whether the variances are equal or not. And just a minute, this is actually t-test. So if the two sets belong to different groups, you first have to do this test called a CF test to check for the variances. If the variances are equal, then you perform this T test assuming equal variances. If the variances are unequal, then you perform this T test assuming unequal variances. And in case you're faced with just with a situation where you have to compare more than two sample sets, then we perform this method called as ANOVA. Okay. So ANOVA is like, it's an acronym for analysis of variance. Okay. So basically whatever you see in these yellow boxes, right? So those are the different types of hypothesis tests that we perform on the data. Okay. Now, let me talk a bit about these sets that I have mentioned here. Okay. So we are saying how many sample sets are we comparing, right? Now, if you just go back to this scenario, let's say there is the situation one. So there's a group of people who have been on a diet, okay? And then there is a situation too where there are two weight loss diets, okay? Now, in the first scenario, right, there is one group of people and there are two sets of readings for them. So one is the weight of the people before the diet and one is the weight of the people after the diet. But both the readings belong to the same group of people, that is. So in that situation, we will use this T-test compared two sample formings. Okay, in the second scenario, there is one group of people who have undergone this diet one, and there's one more group of people who have undergone this diet two. So the groups of people are different, right? So here we are saying two sets belong to different groups, and therefore here we first perform the safe test to see whether the variances are equal, and then if the variances are equal, we perform t-test assuming equal variances. If the variances are unequal, we perform t-test using assuming unequal variances. If there are more than two sets, right? So for example, in this scenario we are talking about only two types of diets, but imagine there are five types of diet or more than two types of diets, right? So in that situation we perform this test called as ANOVA. Okay, so this is just an overview of when to use what type of test. I will go into details of how actually we do this testing. Any questions here till now? Going to the concept. So why do we do this hypothesis testing, or what is the principle behind doing this hypothesis testing? We do it to check if the difference in the means is significant or not significant. Okay, so what do I mean by difference in the means? Just give me a moment. Yeah, see, so let's take that first scenario, right? So I'm just putting scenario one. Okay, so you have a set of people, and you have the weight of the people before the diet, and then you have the weight of the people after the diet. Okay, and then so you have 30 persons who have undergone that diet. The average weight before the diet is 90 kgs. The average weight after the weight is 5 kgs. Okay. Now you compare this 90 kg and you compare this 85 kg. There is a difference of this 5 kilos, right? Now, just by looking at this difference of 5 kilos, you cannot directly say that the diet has helped reduce the weight by 5 kilos. Okay. So what do I mean by that? This 5 kilo reduction of the average group weight from 90 to 85 kg could have also been due to random chance occurrence. Okay, so it could have either been due to the diet, or it could have been due to a random chance occurrence. So in order to check whether it has been a random chance occurrence or whether it has really been due to the diet, we use the hypothesis testing. So that is what I mean when I say the difference between the two weights is statistically significant. So if it is statistically significant, then it means that the reduction in the weight has occurred purely due to the diet. Okay, so that is what we are saying here. We need to check if the difference in the means is significant or not significant. Okay, so what we have to note here is, you know, I think this is where a lot of people don't understand hypothesis testing, or don't have a clear idea of hypothesis testing. Okay, because I personally have talked to a lot of people. They are well versed with all the machine learning algorithms and everything, but you know, this is kind of like the ABCD of statistics. Okay, so but a lot of people struggle in this concept because they don't understand this point here. Okay, so what we need to remember here is the mean of the one group will always be higher or lower than the mean of another group. So for example, what we saw here, so one group, first group, before the diet, the weight is, average weight is 90 kg. After the diet, the average weight is 85 kg. So this difference will always exist. So we do the hypothesis testing just to check whether this difference is a real or significant difference, or it's a not significant difference. Okay, so that's what we're saying. We just need to check whether that high or low is statistically significant or a random occurrence. Okay, so how do we do this check? We compare these two metrics. So one metric is called as this p-value, and the other metric is called as alpha. Okay, so what is this p-value? It is, this p-value is defined as the probability that the observed outcome is due to random chance. Okay, and alpha is called as a significance level. Usually this is taken as 0.05. I will come into what is exactly this, but for now you can just remember that this alpha is generally taken as 0.05. Okay, what do I mean by observed outcome here? Observed outcome is the reduction in the average weight from 90 kgs to 85 kgs. So what is the probability that this reduction in the weight is due to random chance? So that is what we define as the p-value. Okay. Any questions here on the slide? Okay, let me move on to the next one. So how you okay, so just assume that you have performed this some kind of a hypothesis testing. So how do you actually read the test result? Okay, so what how you do that is you first perform the test and then you will get a set of results, and that result will display the p-value. Let's say that p-value is 0.03. okay, so what is the meaning of this 0.03? The meaning is that the probability that the observed outcome is due to random chance is 3%, or you can call it just 3%. So why do I say just 3%? Because this 0.03 p-value, we have to compare it with this alpha value. So we are saying here, right, p-value, you have to compare the p-value and the alpha. So you have to compare that 0.03 p-value with this alpha, that is 0.05. okay, and if this p-value is less than 0.05, then you do something called as this reject null hypothesis. Okay, this basically means the difference in the group, sorry, the difference in the means of the groups is statistically significant. Okay, if this p-value, or so in this case the p-value is 0.03, which is less than 0.05, which means the difference is statistically significant. Okay, if this p-value is greater than or equal to 0.05, then you do not reject the null hypothesis. Then this essentially means that the difference in the means of the groups is not statistically significant and it is just a random chance occurrence. Okay, so what is the meaning of this null hypothesis? This basically means the difference in the means is null or zero. Okay, which means means of both groups are the same. Okay, so I'll just come back to this example that we have here. So essentially the mean of this first group, or the before diet, is 90 kgs. The mean of the after diet is 85 kgs. So the null hypothesis basically says that there is no real difference. See, there is a quantitative difference that you observed between 90 and 85. Okay, but whether that quantitative difference is significant or real, so that is what we need to check. And that null hypothesis basically tells you that this 5 kg difference that you see is not real or not significant. Okay, so that is why you're saying the difference in the means is null or zero. So that is why we call this as a null hypothesis, which basically means both the means are the same, means of the both groups are the same. Okay, so let me just take a few steps back here. So we are saying if the p-value is less than 0.05, we reject the null hypothesis. So what do you mean when you reject the null hypothesis? We reject the assumption that means of both groups are the same. Okay, which in turn means the means are statistically significant, or the difference in the means is statistically significant. Okay, and if you do not reject the null hypothesis, then you conclude that the means of the both groups are the same. Okay, I will actually explain in the next step as to how exactly we calculate or arrive at this p-value. But if you have any questions until now, please let me know.
Sai, like the 0.05 value, is it fixed for all kind of analysis, maybe irrespective of number of rows or data?
Yes.
Okay.
So why do we take it as 0.05 as the cutoff? Because you see this definition, the probability that the observed outcome is due to random chance. Okay, if this difference is less than, so when you say 5%, you're anything that has a random chance probability of less than 5%, you're saying it is statistically significant. Okay, which is to say you're giving very, very little room for a random chance occurrence. You're just giving a 5% room for a random chance occurrence. On the other hand, if you give a 20% room for a random chance occurrence, it won't be the right thing to do, because anything that happens due to random, right? So that's why you're saying the probability that the observed outcome is due to random chance is just 3%, or it is very, very less than 5%. So 5% is what is usually taken as the cutoff level or the significance level.
So Sai, see, what should be the connection between the null hypothesis and the actual test we are performing? Because typically, the null hypothesis is something that, you know, sort of we assign, right? So we would say, okay, let's take this as the null hypothesis, right?
Right.
But you can take anything as a null hypothesis. the question is, how is the null hypothesis really linked to the test we are performing? Okay, and you know, so for example, you know, yeah, so I just, that's the question. So how is the null hypothesis connected to the test we are performing, and why does the test really, you know, confirm or reject the null hypothesis?
Right. So let me come here. So we have these two sets of readings, right? So we have this weight before diet and weight after diet, right? And when we do the hypothesis testing in Excel, we actually have you know, a parameter where we specify or where we plug in this null hypothesis, basically. I'll just show you. So what you do is you click on this data. You have something called as data analysis, right? And so you go here, and so you have something called as t-test paired two sample for means, right? So why do we call this a paired t-test? Because for the same set of persons, you have two readings. So you have the weight before diet, and then you have the weight after diet. And you click on, when you select this paired two sample for means, and when we click on OK, we have this parameter called as hypothesized mean difference, right? So this hypothesized mean difference basically means this. Yeah, so the mean difference is the difference between this 90 kgs and the 85 kgs. And my null hypothesis, so here, like you said, Chaitanya, here, so the null hypothesis is something that we set, okay? And in this case, we are basically hypothesizing that the difference in the means is null or zero. So that's why here what we usually do is the hypothesized mean difference between the two sets of readings, we give it as a zero, and then this becomes our null hypothesis.
Just okay. To add, Chaitanya. When we were taught this, so we have a condition so that we want to prove. So we always take null hypothesis opposite of it, and we try to prove whether that opposite is true or not. So let's say in this case we want to prove that there was 5 kg loss due to the diet. Okay, but what we are trying to prove is, so we'll take the null hypothesis that it is not true. Once we prove that not true is false, so that means the true is positive. So this way null we always take null hypothesis opposite of what we want to prove, and then we compare it with the alpha value, which depends on the confidence level. Confidence level is something like, in this case we are going for 95% confidence level. Am I correct, Sai?
Yes. 95%.
That's why we are taking alpha value as 0.05.
Yeah. And the alternate thing that we are saying, right? So that is actually called as the alternate hypothesis, as per the terminology. So you have the null hypothesis which states there is no difference, and then you have the alternate hypothesis which says there is a significant difference.
Okay, but what I'm trying to get at is slightly different. I'm just really trying to understand. See, given that so what do we set as a null hypothesis? So that's the key question. And how does it link to the? So here, so basically, what we are saying is, see, there is the mean 90.3, and there is the other mean 85, right? So even if we sort of, let's say, get the significance and all of that, so how does it prove that it is the diet that helped in the process? And also, what do we set as the null hypothesis? You know, these are some of the sort of random questions I have.
Right.
Go
ahead. To make it clear, so let's say you have a hypothesis, some hypothesis, like in this case, we are saying that that diet has helped us to reduce 5 kg. Okay, so the null hypothesis would be exact opposite of it. So the exact opposite, the diet doesn't help us to reduce 5 swap. kg.
I understand the mechanics. I'm just trying to get the clarity. So I went through the same course as you, just so you know.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm just trying to get, I know what the mechanics are. I'm just trying to be more clear about why does it work, right? What are the things, what are the connecting things here, right? And what if, let's say, the hypothesis is slightly different, you know, because the test that we perform is more or less same. So if the hypothesis were to be slightly different, how do we change the test? These are some of the things that I'm trying to get.
So Chaitanya, so as an extension to what Swab just mentioned, right? So this is, you know, this kind of forms the basis of how do we actually form that null hypothesis, where we say the difference in the means of the two groups is null or zero. So which is essentially saying that there is no there is no difference, which in turn means that the diet has not been helpful in reducing the weight. So usually when we say null hypothesis, it it kind of ties in with the what Swab just mentioned, as to say that the experiment has not really been effective.
So the difference between the means is clearly visible, right?
It is, yes. So there is a quantitative difference, but that difference is not statistically significant, is what the null hypothesis basically tells us. The difference will always be there, but the null hypothesis basically tells us that the difference is not statistically significant.
Okay.